Good evening, everyone, and thank you for being here. That was Payal Puri. She didn't introduce herself. And there are five other women who join me who are your hosts today and would love to welcome you. There's Nina, Shuli, Anjali, and Ritu, Payal, and me. We call ourselves the ladies in black or the black sena, largely because you need a sena to do anything in the world today, and also as a way of identifying ourselves. So if you see us women in black, you know we are your hosts. I also really particularly want to thank you for being such a mature electorate that you didn't give your vote to any one party, but you have given your vote to us. And on an IPL evening, to see all of you here in such large numbers, so really a big, big thank you to you. We feel the single largest party here today. So before we really get into the program of the evening, just a few words about algebra. Many of you asked with great trepidation and anxiety why we call this club algebra and whether you were in for a, you know, a revisitation to the nightmares of your childhood. But really our intention, in fact, is to counter all neuroses, all psychoses, and it is really to to drown the ghost of maths forever from everybody's life, that we decided to call algebra, algebra. But there's also a very beautiful meaning. It's an Arabic word, and it means the science of restoration and balance. And by, to a large extent, that really is what we try to do with this club, with this platform, to create an environment and a space where you can have the kind of conversations that will attempt to restore, balance and calm to our public conversation. A big attempt of algebra is also to create a space for courteous dissent, a space to encounter worlds that you wouldn't normally encounter, to be challenged in your perspectives, to meet people whose ideas will spark you, but also perhaps make you reflect and move from the settled positions in which you live, and also perhaps with empathy enter shoes that you haven't actually thought of inhabiting. And to a large extent, that is what we've done through the spectrum of speakers. We've had more than 70 events in Delhi and Gurgaon, more than 140 speakers over the last year and a half. And we would love to come to Bangalore to share that experience with you. We hope to be here as a club from once a month moving forward. And if indeed all of you enjoy this evening and would like to become a part of that community, do write to us at Team Algebra. You would have got an invitation. Write back to us and let us know about that. So moving on from there, we are really, really excited about the lineup of speakers we have today, because though they are from very disparate worlds, there's a kind of commonality and common thread to all of them. All three of them really are expanding the center. They're a kind of bridge between very vexed conversations. And the first conversation this evening is about Adi Shankaracharya, the great seer of Hinduism, who lived in the 7th century and re-articulated the fundamental concepts, the spiritual and cosmological concepts that underpin the idea of Hinduism. In a way, we can't think of a more important way to start this conversation, not just because of its profundity, its intellectual curiosity, its provocations, but because it is settled, it is situated in an environment where there are many big civilizational questions, very vexed conversations going on about who we are, what religion really constitutes, what is the nature of Hinduism, the articulation of Hinduism as it is being articulated today, the battle between Hinduism and Hindutva. And in all of that, Shankaracharya plays a very, very big role. It is a very timely reminder that the central tenets of Hinduism were profound. They were about the nature of, the cause and effect, the nature of the universe, the relationship between the mind, the body, and the senses, to really go beyond the restriction of the human mind to understand the nature of universe itself. And those concepts are so profound that it deserves a re-articulation. Shankaracharya did that in the 7th century. We need that re-articulation now, as I said, because this operates at many levels. We are living at a time when we do have apparent and self-appointed votaries of the religion saying that there was internet in the time of the Mahabharata, that Ganesha's nose is an example of plastic surgery, or that, that we had incubation and we could incubate babies because Gandhari had 100 sons come out of vessels and flesh. And, so wonderful mythical stories are being equated with science. A very important aspect of Pavan Varma's book is a chapter which gives actually the scientific validations at the very outlying edges of physics today, through cosmology, through quantum physics, and through neurology, the validations that are coming through for Shankaracharya and the articulation of the Vedanta, which he did in the 7th century. Now, why I say this is important is because it is coming at a time when liberal Hindus have also, in reaction to the Hindutva Brigade, started to eschew everything about Hinduism. There's a kind of knee-jerk reaction. And so we're really caught in these extremes. The Pavan Varma's book comes as a bridge between those extremes of assertion and rejection. It comes with the kind of intellectual rigor, with the ownership and the engagement and curiosity that we do need to bring to our own heritage. And so, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to talk much further about it. It's really like a thriller story in many ways, to look at what the seers who articulated the Vedas and the Vedanta and the Upanishads were doing 2 millennia before the birth of Christ. It's taken 2 millennia afterwards for science to catch up with that thought. Is that a chauvinistic assertion, or is that really an intellectual and tenable argument? To listen to that, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Pavan Varma, who's not just a polymath and a diplomat and a writer, but a man who's on television studios day in and day out, being part of a party and yet being indeterminate. And I use that word because really the beauty of Hinduism is at its heart, that it's an indeterminate idea, system of thought, religion. And Pavan stoically insists on that intellectual indeterminism to speak on the principles of what he stands for and not merely to be identified by his party positions. For all those reasons, we'd like to celebrate him. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Pavan Varma. Thank you, Pavan, for being here. And for this entirely new audience, I think this is the first time we're going to be talking about your book. And, you know, I've been so excited about it. I'd urge all of you to pick up the book because, as I said, it's really like an intellectual thriller. To start with, Pavan, you know, for those who are not familiar with the Shankaracharya, would you really, in a nutshell, capture why, of all the characters that fill up the annals of Hinduism, why is Shankaracharya such a seminal figure and why is he such an interesting figure? What was he articulating that still stands the test of time?
Well, I think, Shoma, the sheer compression of cerebral energy that you see in the systemic and rigorous structure of philosophical thought that Adi Shankaracharya built has few parallels anywhere in the realm of philosophy or that of ideas. Quite apart from that, it's a fascinating life. In 788, a man is born in Kaladi in Kerala. And 32 years later, because that's all that he lived, he dies, he takes samadhi, as Hindus would say, in Kedarnath, right in the Himalayas. And he traverses the length and breadth of this land not once, but 3 times, by foot, having chosen for himself the life of a peripatetic teacher. So, for both his life and for the sheer profundity of thought, the fealty to logic, the eclecticism and openness of mind, and the ability to reinvent the Upanishads, which are themselves one of the most remarkable documents. Let me preface this by saying, I have the highest and deepest respect for all faiths. I am a Hindu, but I would like to be a kind of Hindu that I think Hinduism is. Hinduism has no one pope, no one text, no one prescribed congregation, no particular one temple, not even one god at the level of Ishwar. In this kind of scenario, to postulate a kind of thought process which transcends all of this and gives to Hinduism a unifying and binding force based on Maulik Soch, the power of original thought, in itself was a great achievement. So for all these reasons, Adi Shankaracharya.
So Pavan, before we get into the excitements of his life, and you know, as Pavan said, he merely lived till the age of 32, but ended up becoming so seminal because he was really at this interstice between the two big streams of Hinduism. And I'm going to let Pavan articulate that. So as I said, before we get into the exciting incidents of his life, again, for the audience, will you articulate what was the Advaita philosophy that he was re-articulating and how it was really in contradiction to the other great stream of Hinduism, which is devotion and faith and, you know, kind of anthropological ideas of God?
You see, Hinduism has always had the ability to assimilate more than one belief in what the ultimate truth can be. The great thinkers of Hinduism have not been Shrishti Chintaks, that is, those who examine empirical ideas. They have been Paramarthik Chintaks, those who are seeking answers to the possibility of cosmic truths. And imagine, Shoma, 4,000 years ago in forest academies, there is a sage whose name is unknown because no one knows who wrote the Upanishad. And they are in a conversation with disciples, these seers, and there is a dialogue. There is not an imposition. There is a dialogue where the student seeks and the sage answers not in terms of absolute certitudes, but elliptically, in terms of profound insight, almost as if in passing about what that can be, the four Mahavakyas of the Upanishad, Tat, Tvam asi, that thou art. Aham brahmasmi, I am Brahm. Pragyanam Brahm, Brahm is consciousness. These are the great Mahavakyas. And so this conversation starts, and from there develop six systems of Hindu philosophy. The Nyaya, the Vaisheshik, the Sankhya, the Yog, the Pur Mimansh, the Uttar Mimansh. I'm saying this in another 20 seconds. Sorry, I'm sounding like a TV debate. But I'm saying this to you to understand what is the range of thought. And so six systems of Hindu philosophy emerge, of which five can technically be called atheist, because they are not speaking of God. They are speaking about the difference between the permanent and the impermanent, the eternal and the transient, the lasting and that which passes away. That is the quest. And so, in these six systems of philosophy, which debate with each other, Shastrarth, the ability of dialogue. There are also schools like Charvak school, which is a materialist school, which says there is not even the sanctity of the Vedas, and religion itself has been invented to exploit the poor, which Marx said 2000 years or 3000 years later. So therefore Hinduism has many strands of thought, of which Advaita is a completely non-dualistic school of thought, which tries to understand, after all, what this Brahmand, this universe is. And its pivotal notion, before you come to science, is that the all-pervasive energy throughout this cosmos is Brahm. And Brahm is nirgun, beyond attributes. It is beyond definition. It is immeasurable amatra. It's undifferentiated consciousness, nirvishesh chin matram. It is all-knowing, sarva-pratyaya darshanin. It is pervasive, ekam ek sarva-vyapri. It is beyond thought, achintya. It is beyond seeing, adrishta. It is fullness itself, purna. And this Brahm, being the central focus of this philosophy, says, I am Brahm, you are Brahm, the cosmos is Brahm. And then, if that is the case, what is this bewildering plurality about that we see? How do we explain that if all is one, there are many? Nanatva, the plurality of things. And then there is an explication and so on and so forth. But by inference, Brahm says, I mean the philosophy of Advaita says that you and Brahm are the same, and the experience, the inferential experience of that is Sat Chit Anand. Sat Chit Anand. Chit, bliss, Anand. Chit is awareness, Anand is bliss. Bliss and awareness. You are inherently that. You will always be. You always were. And that is your inherent reality. And anything else is an aberration from that, created by two things in primarily, because there is a very rigorous analysis of the mind. The mind consists of buddhi, intellect, ahamkar, a sense of I-ness or ego, and chitta, awareness. When the mind is not still, and when the sense of I-ness becomes too much, you forget who you essentially are, because essentially when the mind is stilled and the ego is subdued, you come to understand that you and that are the same, and there is the experience of that great plenitude called bliss and awareness.
So, you know, I'm going to take the I'm going to take the moderator's privilege of quickly summing up the thing that I was wanting Pavan to distill, which was, you know, what he just said. Very often when it's spoken of in the language of bliss and consciousness, there are those who, as he said, there are schools of atheists, there are others who are atheists, who tend to reject that as so much spiritual hocus pocus. But what's fascinating, both in the book and as you keep reading, that so much of it really is about scientific truth. And one of the things that Shankaracharya enunciates about the Advait is that even the nature of reality, Maya as we call it, is both, you know, it's a beautiful phrase in Pavan's book that it's not, it is unreal, but it is not illusory, because it really depends on the vantage position from which you're experiencing the world. So it's both sat and asat, truth and untruth, because it depends from which consciousness you're experiencing that world. If it is as a human being and within the framework that we are all sitting here, then it is real. But, you know, if it is from a higher consciousness, then it is unreal. So these are really the profound things that Shankaracharya was discussing, the nature of the cosmos and the Brahman and the consciousness and the nature of human reality as we experience it. So Pavan, again, before we move, as I said, to the scientific validations that your book looks at about the nature of the universe that physics is discovering and how close it is to the idea that Shankaracharya and the Upanishads were putting out, will you quickly talk about a couple of incidents in his life which again capture the genius of this culture and the system of thought, which are the two fights, you know, the intellectual fights that he had with Madan Mishra, why it's so seminal, and then with his wife, Ujjaya Bharati, who's called Sharada later.
See, I don't like the word fight.
I was just using the commonplace language that we are accustomed to, you know, but intellectual debate.
It was a dialogue, and that is a lesson that we need to learn today. There can be differences of opinion, but at least in India, there has been an established and verifiable tradition where you can resolve the differences, not through the gun, but by dialogue. Now, the greatest dialogue in Shankaracharya's life, let me sum it up in, like TV, 40 seconds. Born in Kerala.
You've been so conditioned, Pavan. I'm waiting. We have 40 minutes.
Born in Kerala. Obviously a child prodigy. Mother a widow. The child wants to be a renunciate. The mother doesn't want to let him go. She has no other support. He's the only child. And so there is an apocryphal story about how he shouts out to his mother, I went to Kaladi. One thing I want to say about his life, I did not write it in my study. I have visited almost every place associated with Adi Shankaracharya's travel across India. And it's interesting, 1200 years ago, that the four mutts that he set up, Sringeri, Dwarka, Puri, Joshimat, are indeed what India is today, the civilizational map of India. But to come back to what I was saying, Kaladi. He says to his mother, "A crocodile has caught my foot. Either you give me permission to leave and become a renunciate, or I die." And the mother, like all mothers, agrees for him to go. And at the age of 8, he travels by foot to Omkareshwar, a beautiful spot on the Narmada. And at the Narmada, he has chosen Govindapad.
Pavan, I'm sorry, I am going to play a TV moderator and not let you speak about the Peets, because I really want to come to the science part. It's so unusual. Do talk about the two encounters
Two encounters. Well, since I've been cut short.
Courteously controlled.
Yeah, but I have to come to what you're saying by saying that from Omkareshwar, which was an academy, he went to Varanasi. And from there then, being a peripatetic traveler, he had a difference of opinion between the Purva Mimamsa school, which believed that the practice of rituals as prescribed by their Vedas, Karma Kand, by themselves lead to salvation. And Adi Shankaracharya's path was Gyan Marg, the path of knowledge, not ritual. And so this famous debate takes place. It is disputed where, but I have seen spots marked along the Narmada today where people claim and monuments are built saying this is the exact spot where this Shastrarth or great debate took place. It was with Mandan Mishra. And both were giants. And it was a debate in which Adi Shankaracharya makes Mandan Mishra's wife as the empire. Look at the civility of the debate. And compare it with the discourse today. Here is a man who is debating the fundamental tenets, and it captured the imagination of India. Don't ask me how, even if there was no internet. It went on for weeks, if not months, and people followed every intricacy of argument and debate. Again, two giants debating. And ultimately, the condition was that whoever loses will become the follower of the other. The wife is the empire. Mandan Mishra loses, becomes the follower, and there is a footnote to it if you want me to go into it.
Yes. As I told you, algebra is marked with civility. You know, you can begin to see that already. Have you ever heard Pavan ask anyone's permission before? Pavan, I did actually. The footnote is beautiful because after Mandan Mishra becomes the disciple of Shankaracharya, it is the wife now who challenges the Shankaracharya and actually sets him off kilter. So quickly share that story and then we'll come to the rest.
Well, after Mandan Mishra loses, his wife says, the debate is not yet over. As his wife, I am one part of him as he is one part of me. And therefore, I will now carry on this debate. And she asks Adi Shankaracharya questions relating to the Kama Shastra. Now, he's a sannyasin. And while he is tremendously knowledgeable about many things, this is not one of his fortes. So he says to the honorable lady that if you kindly give me 30 days, I will return. And the story goes, because remember, nothing in mythology is random. If there is a Maryada Purushottam Ram, there has to be a Leela Purushottam Krishna. If there is a Sita, there has to be a Radha. So the story goes that as he left, there was a funeral taking place in which a young prince who had died prematurely was being taken for cremation. And by his yogic powers, Adi Shankaracharya reincarnates himself in that body, and the prince miraculously rises to great celebration. And Adi Shankaracharya leaves his own body in a cave, as I describe in my book. That cave is marked out even today along the Narmada. Now when he goes to the palace and with the wives of the young prince, he discovers the great joys and pleasures and secrets of sensuality. And he returns, he almost forgets to return, he's enjoying himself so much, that some of his disciples come and begin to sing before him Nirguna Bhajans, so that he remembers what his true calling is. And therefore he remembers and comes back just in time before the king's soldiers discovered his own body, and comes back to his body, resumes the debate, wins the debate, and she and her husband, Ubhay Bharti and Mandan Mishra, become his followers. Now, why this story? The story is because nothing remains unlinked in Hinduism. The four purusharths of Hinduism are dharma, artha, kama, moksha. And you'll be surprised that in the first chapter of the Kama Sutra, Vatsyayan allows an imaginary question to be asked to him by, not an imaginary, a question to be asked to him by an imaginary interlocutor. Why do we need this book? And Vatsyayan's answer is that the four purushas, dharma, artha, kama, moksha, each of the first three carried out in proportion and none in exclusion, lead as part of a balanced life automatically to the fourth, which is moksha. In other words, even the pursuit of the sensual within a balanced life has validity, and if it has validity, it's not enough to be just a lover. Try to be an accomplished lover. Therefore, partly to validate the point and partly to enhance his reach not only among renunciates but to lay people, householders, this story, perhaps apocryphal, has been added to that great dialogue and debate which takes place with Mandan Mishra.
And you know, in fact, just listening to Pavan, I was thinking that the central idea there also is that you cannot intellectually argue something that you haven't experienced, or you know, demolish that. And so again, it's a wonderful message that, for instance, our Hindutva brethren who fight against love jihad or boys and girls holding hands in parks, they should maybe...
ignorant.
No, maybe they should apprentice themselves and do a little bit of it themselves, you know. They might just become as enamored as Shankaracharya got with the life of love jihad or anything else indeed. You know, I'm just quickly going to share one more story, and I'm going to do it because it's quicker, but it's much in the same vein. Is that there's also, you know, speaking about these two great streams of Hinduism, there's of course the whole issue of caste. And one of the people who question Shankaracharya is a Chandal. And he says that if the Brahman and your idea of Brahman is true, that there is one consciousness that pervades the universe and runs through each of us, then how is there this caste which separates me from being, you know, because they could not be given the Brahmanic knowledge that the Vedas stood for. And because he challenges Shankaracharya in that way, Shankaracharya has to concede that it is true. If the proposition of the Brahman has to hold true, then the Chandal is equal and on par with any Brahmin as well, and consciousness runs through him as well. So even the idea of caste is broken out of that Advaita philosophy.
In fact, immediately after that incident, he wrote that five shlokas called Manish Panchakam. Panchakam is five, in which every last line is Chandalostusta tu jvidosu, twice born or Chandal, Guru Reshtya, like my guru you are, if you've understood that Brahm equalizes all of us. Manisha mama, that is my resolve.
So that's beautiful. So now I'm going to come to science. And as I said, why the scientific chapter, the validation, is so interesting is because there is now so much hocus pocus around this that we automatically reject even profound streams of thought. So Pavan, will you share that, you know, what is it? I know it's a big question. It's a huge chapter. Pick two or three ways in which... let's start with the cosmology, then we'll come to quantum physics and neurology. You know, so just start with the sort of really big cosmic thought that is being found out in physics, which validates the Shankaracharya's idea of consciousness running through the universe.
First of all, my attempt to correlate a philosophical vision to some of the discoveries of science most recently. Please do not put it in the Dinanath Batra school of Hinduism. I do not belong there. This is a rigorously researched attempt to say that what the philosopher can see through the vision of a philosopher is being validated through the microscope and the telescope. Now, I'll just quickly go through four or five examples. 1200 years ago, and before that 3000 years, 4000 years ago, through the Upanishads, Brahm is defined as infinitude. Brahmand is amatra, immeasurable, that which cannot be measured by any yardstick. Now, what is cosmology telling us today? Cosmology tells us that we are part of one galaxy called the Milky Way. The Milky Way is 150,000 light years across. Light travels at the speed of 300,000 kilometers per second. This is already enough to boggle your mind. But cosmology is now telling us through the eyes in the sky that there are at least 125 billion more such galaxies, each with at least 200 billion stars that are twice the size of the sun. And cosmology is telling us further that at every second, the universe continues to expand at the speed of light. If you put three dots on a balloon and blow into it, just as the dots will begin to become further to each other, in that manner this universe continues to expand. And Stephen Hawking goes even further to say, along with some other physicists, that there is nothing to disprove the fact that there is not just one universe, but that there could be multiverses. Recently, a group of scientists have discovered a cluster called Saraswati, which is 600 million light years away. 4,000 million light years away and 600 million light years across. Now this is happening in the universe around us. And we are a tiny speck here. So infinitude. The second was that this infinitude is eternal. Now, again, cosmology tells us that the universe is at least 13.7 billion years old. Billion. Even our sun is about 5 billion years old. And in case you are a bit worried, in another 4 billion years, it will become a tiny dwarf and fade away when it runs out of its hydrogen. We'll see what happens to our descendants. So, that's the way. Now, what do the scientists do? Scientists want an answer. They say there was a big crunch, a big bang, from which the universe started from an infinitesimal microscopic, and there was an inflationary expansion to create the universe. But this begs the question, and scientists are asking it today, that if there was a big bang that led to it, why can't there be by a reverse order a big crunch when everything will collapse again? In other words, what was will be, will die, and something new will arise. That is the eternal cycle of time, best illustrated by the iconic figure of Shiva's Tandav. So eternal. Thirdly, it is indivisible. This universe is indivisible, and the only thing I want to mention, there's so much facts in the book, but an EPR experiment was carried out in 1935, which is called the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen experiment. And that showed, amazingly enough, that if two electrons are taken, and so long as they are on the same axis, the quantum of their spin and the direction of their spin will correlate. So they took one electron, which is in Bengaluru, and took the other to Tokyo, and they found that once they are put in the same axis, the spin and the quantum of spin becomes identical, as if they were with them each other at this place. Now, you can take it to the moon. You can take it to Seattle. You can take it anywhere you want, that axis, the moment they are in axis and congruent. Now, what completely flummoxed scientists is that this information between these two electrons is being conveyed faster than the speed of light. If this does not speak of an indivisible universe which is correlated in some manner beyond our understanding, what can? But this is exactly what the seers said, that this is akhand. The universe is indivisible. Shankaracharya argued that the reality that we see is not the reality that is. Not that it doesn't exist. Quantum physics has completely changed our notion of reality. You are just empty space with waves of form running through you. It is my sensory abilities that see you as you are. The world was simple in Newtonian physics. One proton, one atom. Now there are 200 particles. And each particle is either a wave or a particle depending on its whim. It can't even be measured until you measured it. It ceases to exist and it exists again. 96% of the universe is dark matter about which we know nothing. So quantum physics says that the reality we see is not true. And yet you can't deny that the reality see. So at the philosophical level, what Adi Shankaracharya said, ignorance makes us see reality as it is. The moment your perception arises of what it is, it's not that the reality changes, but your perception of it that changes. In other words, the serpent and the rope analogy. So long as you think the rope is a serpent, the serpent exists. The moment you realize it's the rope, the serpent ceases to exist. Lastly, last 2 points, consciousness. Now, in all of this, today, be it Max Planck, be it Erwin Schrödinger, be it Einstein. By the way, Einstein's completely put Newtonian physics on its head to re-endorse once again the Vedantic insight about matter and time. Time is relative. When you see the sun, you are not seeing the sun as it is today. You are seeing what the sun was 8 minutes ago, because that is the amount of time it takes for light to reach us. That's when you see it. When you look up at the night, at the sky, you see stars. Many of them have ceased to exist. Because by the time that light has traveled here, they could have become supernovas. That is the relativity of time. Somewhere somebody is seeing Mahabharata going on. The past, the present, the future, they all intermingle and become a diffuse mass of the continuity of time. So mass is energy, energy is mass. Einstein. So many scientists today are saying that you cannot explain this unless you admit that there is an underlying consciousness somewhere in operation. Pragyanam Brahm. I am not saying it. Max Planck says consciousness is primary, but the material world is derivative. Schrödinger, these are all Nobel laureates. They say there is a consciousness, a unitary consciousness that pervades the universe. And finally the point, Shoma, about Atma Cha Brahm. In other words, that the same Brahm is within us. Today, there are experiments going on in Harvard, in laboratories, where they have discovered that although the brain itself is a material object, it has a neurological ability for self-transcendence where it becomes an observer. That observer can be sidelined because of the assertion of ego and the constant chatter of the mind. It's like a monkey jumping all the time from one branch of a tree to another. That's the mind. You still it. And so I just want to mention an experiment of an experienced meditator, Andrew Newberg. You should read that book, Andrew Newberg, Why God Won't Die. And he is sitting now in a lab at Harvard and he's meditating. And to his small finger is attached a string. And as he meditates and is about to slip into the deepest moments of meditation, he gives a tiny tug to that thread that alerts the scientists who do a spect of his brain as he's in his deepest moments of meditation. And they see the colors of the brain changing. The normally most active part of the brain, that settling down to cool greens and blues. It's called the orientation association area. And these scientists are saying now that within us, when the brain is still, that's why the proven benefits of meditation, there arises within you what they have called AUB, absolute unitary being, where all division cease and you feel you are one with the other. And the experience is that of Chid and Anand, bliss beyond description and awareness beyond any definition.
Thank you, Pavan. That's not to signal the end of the conversation, just that if that felt like a, you know, Kim Jong had just sent a firing squad at you of ideas. It's not like that. The book really is written because he's trying to compress so much into the 5 minutes that he's been given. It might seem bewildering, but really the chapter in that book is something to be read because it is such an easy sort of hand-holding through very, very complex ideas. And I would really urge you to read it. I've been excited ever since I've read it. Again, just to share a couple more ideas, which Pavan puts out in the book. One of the things that Shankaracharya says is that consciousness has no property, it's propertyless. And, Niels Bohr, again, one of the physicists who's a master of quantum physics, comes down to saying that of these 200 particles, it has absolutely no property. It has no definition except at the moment at which you measure it, at which point your human brain gives it a property, you know, and that really is again bringing us back to the idea of Maya and illusion and unreal, that the world itself has no property until you see it. There are also others talking about superpositions, you know, that up until you decide something is something, it potentially exists in all possible forms, you know. So it completely blasts your idea of empirical reality. And again, just to be a prachar for Pavan's book, that there is Einstein, there's Stephen Hawking, you know, he's mentioned Max Planck and others, all of whom at the end of their lives are literally using the language of this to say that if we are to understand the nature of the universe, we have to give up the idea of reason and come to some understanding of consciousness. Across the board, physicists are using that word of consciousness, and that's fascinating as it comes across in the book.
Last thoughts, if I may.
Okay, I was actually going to move to something else, but sure. No. Last thoughts have to be put forward.
I'm a very disciplined man, you ask.
Okay. Pavan, what were your last thoughts?
No, my last thoughts were that with such a grand edifice of thought, as I said right in the beginning, the problem with Hinduism and its strength is that it's a way of life. And very often you therefore become severed from its remarkable philosophical underpinnings. And Hinduism then gets reduced to ritual. And ritual in the hands of the ignorant becomes a very dangerous weapon. And I will fight till my dying breath to prevent this great religion from being reduced to its lowest common denominator by self-appointed evangelists. And I will do so by going into Hinduism. Because that is the only way you can do it. You cannot do it by rootless cosmopolitanism. You cannot do it by being a reflex secularist, where you've read the Ramayana in a comic book. You don't know anything about Kalidas, but you know Shakespeare. You have to have roots, but not as xenophobia, not as chauvinism, but as a matter of curiosity about where, who am I and where I've come from. And to see some of the great ancient wisdom and refinements, not in terms of ownership, but as something that you must be familiar with. And when then you speak with authenticity. In my most turbulent debates with those, some of these self-appointed evangelists, they are not keen to debate with me.
Because you know your shit.
Because I know more than them about Hinduism, quite simply put.
So, in fact, Pavan, what's wonderful is that that's the precise question I was going to ask you, you know, about just how it's been mutilated by those who put themselves out as custodians of Hindutva. But there's a very, there are two questions, and we have literally 5 minutes, so I'm going to ask you to be short. Two questions. One is that because Hinduism in its profundity understands the indeterminate nature of the universe and of human life, you know, the essential transience of it, what impact does that have on ethics? You know, all other Semitic religions create a very strong ethical structure within which society must function. Hinduism, you know, to use a friend's famous phrase, is a very slippery slope on the grounds of ethic, you know, because there's nothing really to hold you. So your thoughts on that. And secondly, that what is a real true travesty is that the Shankaracharya's thought in Advaita, coming out of the Vedanta and the Upanishads, is actually used later by Aurobindo Ghosh, Swami Vivekanand, Dayanand Saraswati, and, you know, even more cynically by Savarkar, to actually create the blueprint of Hinduism as becoming a religious nationalism, and then, you know, for it to be infantilized now to what Dinanath Batra and the rest of the Hindutva Brigade do. So this grand thought that we've been discussing all evening actually ends up becoming the blueprint of Hindutva today. Can you talk about both those things?
Since you want my answer to be short, your question was longer. However, I will try. It is true that if you've experienced Brahm Anubhav, the experience of Brahm, at that level of self-realization, human categories of right and wrong become meaningless. But it is a travesty of this to say that therefore there are no ethics. Adi Shankaracharya said that the pursuit of knowledge is at two levels. Paravidya, that is that which takes you to ontological discovery. And aparavidya, that which is vyavaharik or practical. At the practical level, he said that all the virtues that you can talk of, to be free of envy, to be free of greed, to be free of hatred, to cultivate equanimity, to not lie, to not steal, all of these contribute to equanimity of mind and therefore prepare you to move from aparavidya to paravidya. So there is pravratti lakshana dharam, with that, for a person who is in complete awareness and has transcended human barriers, and there is nivritti lakshana dharam, which belongs to people who are still on the path of that endeavor. That is why Adi Shankaracharya is often called the great synthesizer also. Shanmat sthapakcharya. In other words, he brought together all these religions because he wasn't against it. He said, you practice yoga, that's good. You practice these virtues, bhakti, the most moving stotras. Bhaja Govindam, Mudmate. Samprapte sannahite kale, nahi nahi rakshate dukhra karane. So this is Shankaracharya. He can write the most moving hymns to a personal God because he says there is nothing wrong, because atma samarpan, surrender, prapatti, the negation of your sense of self, all of these prepare you for that experience of Brahm Anubhav. So they have their role, they have, so there is a system of ethics. Your second question I've forgotten.
The second question was, you know, to again comment on how the travesty of the fact that the Advaita philosophy becomes the blueprint, you know, because later on Swami Vivekanand, Dayanand Saraswati and Aurobindo Ghosh, I'm leaving Savarkar out of it, you know, because they are uncomfortable with the kind of multiplicity of Hinduism, the many streams, the many gods, the many experiences of the path to consciousness, they start to reject all of that and to kind of codify it. And they choose this great pride in the Advaita and the Vedas. And I'm saying that that becomes the blueprint of the Hindutva today, you know, this harking back to the Vedic past. So if you can
I'll give you the shortest answer possible. Any attempt to straitjacket the sheer effervescence of thought processes within Hinduism is to mutilate Hinduism. You may have a choice, I may have a choice. Bhakti is a path to salvation, Jnana is a path to salvation, karma, which Adi Shankaracharya argued against, but karma without the notion of abhyudaya, without the notion of material gain for oneself, karma itself through self-effacement is a path to salvation. Even the sensual is a path to salvation. Krishna stands there. I have a book on Krishna. Krishna the lover. So, there are many paths. There are many paths.
In fact, the Shankaracharya, fascinatingly, being such an austere and intellectually rigorous, propounder of cosmic thought, was also a great believer in Tantra, and he sets up the greatest tirths of the tantric path to salvation as well. So it's again about this assimilation and bridge building and allowing for multiplicity.
True. All his peats are called Shakti peats, which is to recognize the importance of, what is a good word to use, what Maya itself is Shakti. The Brahm is constant. From Brahm, what creates? Brahm without Shakti is nothing. If you go to Srinagar or Kashmir, where Shankaracharya traveled and had a debate with Shaiv, Kashmir Shaivism, it's exactly what Advaita is. Brahm is absolute, all pervasive, but Brahm by itself is not enough. You need the Shakti within Brahm, and that Shakti is the female primacy, the power. And two without each other don't matter, cannot matter. They are equal. And therefore, every mutt of Shankaracharya has a Shakti peet.
Thank you very, very much.
One thing I want to say. Yes. I've written 21 books by now as a full-time diplomat and now in politics. But I can tell you, to move from the superficial turbulence of politics very often to the absolutely rarefied atmosphere of philosophy, it was one of my most difficult tasks.
Pavan, the beauty of algebra, if I may say so, is that you always get unexpected gifts. You're never going to believe this, you're going to get 5 more minutes because the city of Bengaluru wants you to have 5 more minutes. Yashwant Sinha is stuck in traffic outside the hotel.
So, you know, it's always easy. Please ask. Please ask.
Oh, please ask. We are both so stumped by this gift, we don't know what to do, you know. Pavan, you know, again, it's fascinating to understand, like you just said, why you moved away from the hurly-burly of everything you do to get down to this book. So I'd love to ask you about the trigger. And the second is that, you know, as I was saying earlier, we have this knee-jerk, liberal Indians have a knee-jerk way of rejecting anything now to do with Hinduism because you're so devastated by the Hindutva articulation of Hinduism. You know, this city, this state has seen the death of Gauri Lankesh and what proponents of Hindutva can do. So I'd like to ask you that after you've done this book, have you been accosted by your liberal friends for having gone over to the other side? Is there a misunderstanding of why you've done this book?
I don't care. To be honest, I don't care because if those who say that by writing about my perception and research of some of the reasons why Hinduism is a great religion, while retaining my respect with great reverence for all other faiths, if they believe that this is somewhat less secular, so be it. But I know that my voice, based on research into my own religion and a knowledge of other religions and their greatnesses, will make me a more authentic voice of secularism than if I was ignorant. And I want to say this with sincerity to you. The greatest challenge today is to face those who believe they have the right to speak about Hinduism when their evangelism is in direct correspondence to their ignorance. How do we deal with this situation? Are we steamrolled? Do we have a voice? Or do those people who can continue to live either due to indifference or lack of time or because it's not necessary since Hinduism is a way of life, at the periphery of that basic ground of knowledge by which you can counter them? There is not in Hinduism, in the realm of ideas, any legacy or sanction to hatred, violence, and abuse. And that is why there is this great notion, which I repeat time and again, of shastrarth, of debate, of dialogue. Of debate and dialogue which is not one-sided, which is not a monologue. You speak, I listen. I speak, you listen. What has happened to it? And who is mutilating this tradition? By exhorting those whose legacy it is not to become intolerant to those who may not belong to my faith. Who has given them this right? There was a dialogue between Hinduism and Buddhism. It's a civilized dialogue. Whatever the interpreters may say that there was violence meted out against Buddhists, no, it was a civilized dialogue. Religion may on occasion foster violence. Religion may on occasion have people who justify violence. Religion may on occasion be hijacked by hatred. But that is not the essence of all religions. And therefore we need today, especially in our time, in modern times, on the frontiers of technology, to pause. Because we are not merely compartmentalized as modern. We are also people, many of us, as faith, with the right to be atheists. Now this is the legacy to which I am heir. How do I convey it, Shroma, to people? To me, that is the challenge.
So, you know, Pavan, to move to that question which I asked you earlier, that would you then talk about, you know, especially now when we speak so much about Swami Vivekananda, then he's again a figure that everyone is squabbling over. Certainly the Hindu right wants to own him. You know, again, if you would speak about these three figures, Aurobindo Ghosh, Swami Vivekananda, and Dayanand Saraswati, and how this pure Advait thought, which was really an intellectual proposition, ended up becoming the bedrock of Hindu nationalism.
You see, Swami Vivekananda was a Vedantist, as was Swami Ramakrishna. But there is one thing I want to say. There is nothing that is contradictory in Hinduism, because I'll tell you one thing about Indians as a whole. We are harmonious schizophrenics. We live at many planes. We extravagantly humanize our gods. At another level we say, neti neti, beyond all definition. We live this life. We live in this world, we are the most resilient entrepreneurs with our feet on the ground and our eyes on the balance sheet. And we say this world is Maya. So we live with these contradictions. But within Hinduism, there is no contradiction between your pursuit of that Chid Anand, Sat Chid Anand, and bhakti. That's the sanction. What happened after Adi Shankaracharya, which I put in an epilogue to my book, is, you see, Adi Shankaracharya's of Brahm, to which he remained consistent, this attributeless, all-pervasive, cosmic, conscious energy, is much too dry a concept for most human beings. They want a personal divinity. They want to go to the temple. They want to surrender. They wish to pray. They wish to ask. I don't know how many of people of you have been to Puri. The level of familiarity between deity and devotee becomes of a point where there is a temple in Puri. The devotee goes and, as part of the ritual of worship, abuses Jagannath. And it's very interesting to hear how innovative they are in their abuse. Every form, because it is a degree of familiarity. He is confidant, he is beloved, he is friend. There is surrender. What's the barrier? So there is no contradiction between bhakti and between the pursuit of that ultimate knowledge, which is beyond even bhakti. It is the complete identification. It is becoming part of Brahmatmak, where you see, have that perfect intuition, samyak darshan. And it doesn't come only through learning. And this is again a contradiction of Adi Shankaracharya. Not through panditiyam, not through intellectual sophistry, but through balyam, to be childlike, to be humble, to be willing to absorb, to be porous, to be open. He says so. So, I don't know how long it will take for us to fully understand Adi Shankaracharya or for Mr. Yashwant Sinha to arrive. But, but I can go on like this. I was continuing. So now that my savior has arrived and moksha is not far away.
No, but really, thank you very, very much, Pavan. Oh, you're getting a standing ovation. Thank you very, very much, Pavan. You know, as Pavan said, that what is beautiful about this, one is the dialogue, and second, that nothing, absolutely nothing in Hinduism is dogmatic. Nothing, none of the streams say what is. All of it is really about what possibly could be. And I would urge all of you once again, during the drinks break, buy the book, and Pavan will be signing the book. Thank you very, very much, Pavan.